So I'm Ana Rivas, as Tom introduced me with you, and I will be talking today about recovering public space for people with a street experiment. So I will let you know a little bit about my background. I study architecture in Mexico. Then I did a master in graphic design in London. And that's how I start like combining these two passions, let's say, from architecture and graphic design. And during my master, they were asking us to experiment. And I was like wondering, okay, well, how can I experiment graphic design? And I didn't have any idea because, you know, this Copacabana Boulevard, these waves black and white, and I wanted to do something like that, just graphic design in that sense. And then I was like, okay, the supervisor was like, experiment. And then I was like, okay, how to do it? Maybe I can use like temporal materials. And I came up with the idea of using duct tape. So I would not damage the public space or the streets, and I would be able to experiment. So in that time, I live in a neighborhood in London that's called Camden. It's quite popular. I don't know if you have heard about it, but there are some public parks that they were underused. I would even say maybe abandoned sometimes. And for example, here are some of the pictures. And you could see some benches and people was not really using them. And what I wanted to do is to use graphic design, in this case, super graphics, to attract people to the space and to use it, raise awareness that the space is there for them. And yeah, like to really start using it or to open a conversation about the space. There were also like these desire lines. I don't know if you can see my mouse, but some desire lines that people walk not really on the sidewalk, but they desire to walk through maybe the park, and they leave these mark there. So maybe that's a way that we I don't know, city planners, architects, urban planners can listen to them and do the things that people is really showing us how to design maybe the city more human, let's say. So that's what I was doing during my master. And this is based on tactical urbanism that I will talk a little bit about this later. So that's how I started experimenting using public space. And after my master's, I work in a company in Mexico for mobility. And we pay attention more on pedestrians and or on cyclists rather than the space for cars, but I will talk about that also in the next slides. So cities are growing right now, and it is expected by 2050, sorry, that the population in cities will be double. And so we have a big challenge in mobility, and in like there's a lot of demand of housing, and there's traffic congestion. So that's a big challenge that we are facing right now, how people will move. And that's one of our biggest challenges, mobility and the infrastructure. So I like to share this comic because it shows how the cities have been developed. So we start like in rural areas, and then they design some paths for trains, and then like little pathways for transportation, either carts for horses, I don't know what's the name, proper name. Then like the cities continue developing, then the cars, we start using cars, and at the end the cities are designed in the scale of cars instead of the scale maybe of people before. So in order to revert that, we should connect the cities and to make more efficient the way we are moving. And also if we pay attention to that, we will create more inclusive, more safe and resilient and sustainable cities. So as I just mentioned before, we need to implement new strategies, and there's the mobility pyramid where the pedestrians, cyclists are on top, so they are the most vulnerable people, and we should design for them to have more human cities, let's say, so and less car oriented. So after pedestrians and cyclists, we have the public transportation, freight, I think it's called, transport de carga, and at the end we leave motorized vehicles. So first of all, we have to change the mindset. And we have to start also thinking about other ways how we are going to move, so we can start combining, maybe not just using one way for moving, but maybe we combine walking and then maybe using our bicycle or public transportation. But the idea is to stop using cars or use it the less possible in order to have these more sustainable cities. And there are also two ways of designing cities. One is a transit-oriented development where it focuses on the pedestrian scale and also on mixed uses of the of the buildings around the city. And the other one is the 15-minute city, which just gained more popularity lately. But maybe I know that because I'm very involved, but maybe this is the first time you listen about this. So there's the house, there's where people live, and the idea is to that people can reach their jobs, supermarket, and basic necessities within 15 minutes using walking, cycling, and public transportation, and the less the car. And well, we also have to understand what is public space, and it's a complex term to define. There have been many people trying to define it. Sometimes it's also perceived as the left space among the built environment. But if we just like look at the UNESCO public spaces, how they should be is like open and accessible to everyone, regardless gender, race, ethnicity, or socioeconomic level. And lately, or in the 21st century, and even more now with Corona, even virtual spaces are considered public spaces. So right now we are also interacting, and it doesn't like a lot of people, and that can be also a new type of thinking of public space. So that's also very nice to think, or very nice to like a new term to think about. And these are public spaces that we all know. So this is something that we all understand quite well, that this is public space. So this can be some gardens, plazas, markets. This is the Paseo of Copacabana, which I was mentioning you. This was my inspiration to start doing all these. Some memorials are also public spaces, parks, very colorful parks, or games for kids and adults, fountains, and also semi-public spaces like the Sky Garden in London. So it's open for everyone, it's free, but it belongs to a private private owner, but it's open to everyone. So these are different conceptions of a public space. And well, when we have like high quality public spaces, they also have different impacts for us. So they have health, social, economic, and environmental impact. I don't want to go too deep, so I don't want to make it too theoretical. So, so if we have high quality spaces, then we will have also other type of impacts. And the interesting thing to think also is that normally people do not conceive that streets are public space. Or yes, they know that they are public space, but they think that they are exclusive domain of cars. But in the past, streets were also a place where conversation took place, where kids were playing, you know, football, volleyball, or I don't know, like all games, and let's say all, because this doesn't take place anymore. So later, how I show it in the comic, the cities were designed around the cars. And well, I think now we need to start thinking again, like to recover this space for people. And for that, well, there's the tactical urbanism, which are short-term actions that are looking for a long-term change. So this means that we use temporary and very low-cost materials that have a big impact on the public space. So we can use pots, as you can see in this picture. We can use tape, how I just did it during my master's. You can use some furniture. In this case, they have nice tables, but we can use also pallets, some grass and trees, and everything is movable because the idea is that you can adapt the space. And the street experiments, as we see it in the university, I forgot to mention that I'm working right now for the Technical University of Munich, and we do research on street experiments. And Luca Bertolini, a professor of the University of Amsterdam, defined them as intentional temporary changes of the street, just regulation or form that aim to explore systemic change in urban mobility and also in the urban space. So here I'm showing another experiment. This is in Stuttgart, it's called Casa Schützenplatz. And they were recovering, so you can see here in the middle, there were some old parking spaces. And they were recovering every year one parking spot or two more. Like they were doing it by section. So in the beginning, the people were not really happy about that, but then suddenly the people who was against that, they also joined, I don't know, let's say the movement, and people like embraced this type of interventions. And yeah, so this is one of another example of a street experiment. And there are many types. So there are the remarking streets, which are just doing some colorful using paint in the street. There are also repurposing parking. So these are the parklets. You might have heard about it. So where there's a parking spot, you take it out and then you do something different there to see how can you use this space in a different way. So for example, the space that a car used can be used by 12 bicycles, but if you put a car, it's used mainly for one person or two person, and it's used by like more private instead of like making it more public. So it's a public space using by a private owner. And so that's something that we want to change. This is another type of experiment that it's repurposing sections of the street. So it's not the entire street, but you select a certain area where you want to recover the space. And you also do some interventions. This is Piazza Veloveso in Milan. And well, they paint the street. Sometimes they do it in collaboration with citizens, sometimes not. There are many ways of doing this. And the important thing of the street experiments is that sometimes you just need to do it, see how people react to that, learn about the intervention, and maybe just next time do it differently and considering the feedback and the ideas that you learn from the first time you did it. Another type of experiment is the repurposing entire streets. So in the right side, you can see a market. It's called Calle Delgado in Salvador. So they painted the whole street. They relocated the garbage cans because they were just like everywhere. And people say that they feel more safe. And yeah, it's nicer to go when the street is looking like this. They involve an artist to do this. So they involve different type of stakeholders. And on the left, in the left, you have Calles Conscientes from Colombia. It's also another intervention where you gain, again, some space for people. They put a bike lane. They also gain some space from the sidewalks for people, for pedestrians, because sometimes you can see all the space that there was there for cars, but look at the size of the sidewalks. They are minimal. So the idea is to gain space for people. And sometimes even if you do these interventions, like for example, here you can even see one car who, is just parking there or crossing the street, like in that lane, let's say. And this is another example of proposing entire streets, but they took it one step further. But let's say that this was one of the first street experiments that they were done. So this is Strøget in Copenhagen. So in 1954, you can see it was used mainly by motorized vehicles. And nowadays it looks like this. It's a public plaza. So in 1962, they decided to carry out a pilot for 2 years, and they pedestrianized 3 kilometers of the street, and people welcome it. At the end, there were some benefits, there's cleaner air, there's no traffic, there are cab pedestrians. So 2 years later, they decided that they will create this pilot permanent. And then they redesign the street, how you see it here in the right. So they repave the street. And so here you can see in the left how it started and how the pedestrian network start growing. This is from 2013. I don't have the one from nowadays, but it's a nice way to do nice streets for people. Another popular example, it's Times Square in New York. Again, here we could see the streets used for cars for traffic. Then they did a pilot. It was very welcome. Shop owners were afraid that, because they think, my clients come by car, but clients actually don't come by car. Like clients come walking and they enter walking to the stores. And so they created the pilot. It was very welcome. Even more people went there. And then they created a permanent redesign of the space. And well, before these experiments and doing this type of interventions, it was quite complicated. And it needs a long process. Also, sometimes depends on the city context and the city policies. But right now with the Corona crisis, we also start thinking about how it's going to be the public space developed. So streets, as we saw in one of the examples of the experiments, I show sidewalks are very little. And now if we just need to follow the Corona restrictions, we need to have at least 1 meter, 1 meter and a half distance from another user. So we need to have actually wider sidewalks. And most of the sidewalks, they don't comply with this rule, let's say. Another type of experiments that they were boosted with the Corona are the pop-up bike lanes. So for example, in Berlin, you can see here the bike lane, but due to Corona, people try to avoid public transportation. And so the city decided to make wider this bike lane during summer. At the end, there's a controversy if they keep them or not. And there are some parklets as well. So when restaurants start opening their terraces and they put some tables and chairs outside so they can serve the clients, and they can keep also following the Corona restrictions. And I mean, this is also very positive because we start using space in a different way, but we also have to be careful of the privatization again of the public space, because it's open for people, but it's also being used for commercial intention. So there it comes, this controversy until which point we should allow to use the space for commercial purposes. So all these regulations needs to be set now. But it's quite positive that the crisis is boosting this other use of the space. Another example, outdoor terraces. This is in the city of Munich. And the summer streets also in the city of Munich. So they close some streets. On top, you can see the before, and then you can see the after. And it's quite funny because sometimes the people don't use, I was here once in this street, and the people don't really use the street. They use the sidewalks because they are used to that. And it's difficult that they get used to start using the street and this open space for them. And to close, I leave you with this diagram. So of all the challenges that public space or public realm is facing, so one is the climate change that we already knew about it, but it's having this environmental impact is having some positive impacts from COVID. How to make public space accessible, equitable, and inclusive for everyone. So that would deliver some social impacts. With the corona crisis, we have realized that the value of the public space changed from something nice to have to a necessity. And also we realized again that the public space is a limited and valuable resource. So we need to rethink how we are going to redesign the space in the future. So how do you imagine the public space of the future? That's how I'm going to close with this presentation.
Well, thank you, Anna. That's really a wonderful presentation. Actually, I learned a lot. Mm-hmm. As I mentioned, I didn't know anything about reimagining public space and things like that. So before I ask a question, let me ask everyone, does anyone have a question for Anna or a comment? Great.
I'm just trying to find how to word it. Some of the experiments that Anna showed us in the presentation, we have actually been forced to adapt due to COVID. For example, right now where I am in Toronto, indoor dining is not allowed now due to COVID. So, and I know it's the same in New York City, I was there recently. And so people have taken the sidewalks as patios, for example, for restaurants or taking parking spaces. And I see that, a lot of people have had to accept it. But at the same time, it can become counterproductive because now you have all this indoor space. Like, you're not taking it to gain space. You're losing the indoor space anyway. So I know, I guess it was more a comment than actually a question where I was trying to get out. But the idea is great when you're actually going to gain space. Like I agree with everyone, take some parking spaces and turn it into, a little parquet or something. But when you're also wasting in something else, then it's counterproductive at that point.
Yeah, I think it's a different way of seeing it. We always see it from the point of view that we need to gain space from cars. Like cars are our enemies, let's say, if you want to say it like that. And that's why at a certain point when we create a parklet for people instead of cars, that's the way we see gaining the space. But it's also another way of seeing, actually at the moment, interior spaces are not being used. They're underused, let's say. But I don't know, if for example, that's a question for everyone. If you are in wherever you are, if are these type of parklets taking place or also pop-up bike lanes? Thurston, you are here in Germany. This is happening in some of many cities. I don't know. There are many opinions.
Yeah, this to a certain extent. And I have a comment on the cars, our daily enemies, and maybe question to the group, just to guess there's statistics. And there's a finding on, maybe you can guess a percentage, how many hours within a day a car actually stands still. It just doesn't move. Do you know that? Any percentage or in hours a day, you might know?
I should know it, but yeah, it depends. It depends on like the city and yeah. But yeah, a car can be parked, let's say 4 hours at least, like just there. And it's...
I don't mean parking in public, but just the usage or the utilization of a car. Give me some numbers and percentages. What do you think? And maybe out of 24 hours a day, a car stands still X hours or in the, as a percentage?
Five hours, maybe? I don't know.
I would say stays parked around 20, probably, depending on how the commute is. I mean, either it stays parked at your work or it stays parked at your home.
Yeah,
you only actually drive it so long. I mean, okay. I think it stays parked 20 or more, in my opinion, at least my car.
Okay, you're close. I just looked it up to just be sure if the number I had in mind was right. It's actually 95%. So that means in hours, it's 23 hours a day, plus minus that the car is not being used.
Wow,
that's room for optimization, huh? Isn't it?
Yeah.
I don't know the scope of that survey, but it gives us the rough number. Maybe different on continents, but still.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
So yeah, for example, and yes. Sorry.
So for example, us here, we live not in the Cologne area, but an hour outside, rural area, and there'll be we're two persons and. We have two cars, and I would need two cars. One would be sufficient, but okay, for family reasons, a bigger one and a smaller one, okay. But why can I just not put a button on an app and the car just shows up and picks me up? That's the future.
Yeah, right. Yeah,
probably pretty soon with Tesla.
And also, like the average, of users per car or occupancy, it's like 1.5, not even two people per car in general. So it's very similar to what you just said. So actually, like sharing services, multimodality, how I just mentioned in the beginning. Okay, maybe you share, you start your trip walking, then you go to a car, you find a car in an app, maybe. You use it, you go wherever you want, but you don't have a car like the whole year just standing in your garage or in your sidewalk or, yeah.
Anna, Emily has a question for you. So she says, she writes, do you think cities need to have a certain density already for this to work? And she says, I think many American cities are designed for cars. So is it possible to change that retroactively?
Well, for example, if we want to apply the 15-minute city, it would be great to start applying this in dense cities, because we already cars can start like applying this concept. So through some accessibility studies, we can see where some services are missing, and if there's a density, that will be easier to implement. But this concept, it's also applicable in little towns, let's say, but it's more, maybe more complicated, but it density, it's definitely key to start applying this idea of the 15-minute city concept. And how can we start recovering this space can be through the experiments or other methods. But then we can do this analysis, see where it's that service missing, clinic or public space, and then to start to implement it in that area. But yes, density, it will make it definitely easier. And if not, if we don't have a dense city, the idea would be not to continue extending our cities, but to keep them limited, like not to continue extending.
Right.
I hope to answer that question.
I want to bring Gabriela here. because she's from Cuba, and she does the same work that you do in terms of redesigning public space in Havana. So Gabriela, could you speak to us a little bit about what you're doing in Havana?
Yeah, hi all.
Hi.
Thanks for the talk. It was really amazing. I really enjoyed all your drawings summarizing the topic. Well, first of all, we are also trying to introduce this tactical urbanism here in Havana. That's why we developed a project that started with our Cities Space Forum back in November. And we are trying to create a placemaking Cuba network here in Cuba, starting in Havana with some community projects. So I really enjoyed the experience that you showed from Europe and how COVID-19 is more an opportunity than a challenge in terms of public space, at least in my opinion, since we didn't have so many people involved in recovering the public space in the past few years. And right now, everyone has realized, or at least a large number of people, how public space is needed for community interaction, for community well-being, and how people are coming back to their neighborhoods. And I think all these pilot interventions and all these experimental actions that took place during this period of calm hopefully will stay permanent. And well, thank you very much for all the examples. I knew some of them, a lot of them I didn't know about them. And well, I don't have any questions. If you have any questions about Cuba, Havana, how are we working, please ask. And thank you.
Well, yeah, thank you. It's great to know that the placemaking is coming to Cuba, actually. I really would, if you have any social media page or anything, or maybe just keep me posted, because we have an Instagram account from our project. It's called I'm trying to write it down, but
yes, please leave it in the messages in the chat, and I will share mine.
I can see because I have the English. So it's street experiments in Instagram. And we are just showcasing and showing like these interventions around the globe. We are not our research focus is here in Europe because we are funded by the European Institute of Technology, the Urban Mobility Area. But our Instagram account showcases like street experiments from around the globe.
And oh, perfect.
We also have our website, but we are developing it still. Shootexperiments.com, and later this year it might turn into a consultancy or a guideline how to implement these. Like, I mean, there are out there many manuals and many guidelines, but we want to have also our own, and we are going to try to make it different, maybe putting this mobility aspect. And our city your space.
Yes, it's and we are also developing our web page, but I leave it there. We aim to next month it will be ready, hopefully.
Perfect. Yeah, thanks for sharing.
So now that you mentioned mobility, and it's really good that we got in touch. We are also developing a bike parking handbook that with the collaboration of the Dutch government, we will be publishing at the end of the year, because here in Cuba, we have a strong need for bike cycling, and right now we don't have the infrastructure. So we are trying to create a movement that encourages people to use the bikes. And the first step is to create the the conditions, of course, parking, bike lanes that were before during the 90s, but they are lost right now.
Mm-hmm.
And well, I keep you posted about that. It's going to happen in the second half of the year.
Yeah, yeah. But, please share it, and we can also share them in our in the Instagram or in the website, and that would be great just to keep in touch.
Great. Yeah. Thanks. And thanks, Tom, for putting us in touch and for all these amazing talks that you are gathering and showing.
Well, thank you. It's my pleasure. I knew you and Anna would connect. You're doing some very similar work, and I learned a lot. And that's what I like. I really enjoy doing this. And staying on Cuba, and I bet Gray knows this space, but can you tell us a little bit, Gabriela, about Fábrica de Arte?
Oh, yeah. Well, Fábrica de Arte is it was an old factory, which like almost 6 to 7 years ago, it became a cultural center that was developed by X Alfonso, which is a Cuban artist. And the amazing thing is that he gathered all the 7 arts in one building. So it could work for concerts, but at the same time, you are seeing paintings from Cuban artists. You have in one floor maybe a rock concert, and in the ground floor a theater play. So it's really nice. It's a very good meeting point, one of the most famous. And the good thing is that it's very inclusive. So you have everything together. You don't have separate rooms. You pay for art and you get all the art together. And it's really nice because you have an amazing night. Maybe you want just to go out, but at the same time, even if you want to dance, they are introducing the art mostly for young people that usually don't go to museums. And it's a way of showing them another options and improve the cultural to introduce the culture to young people, I'd say.
Mm-hmm.
It is also, yeah. Sorry, a point, it's also a movement that gives visibility for young artists. So anyone can send them their work and they are very happy to expose them. And it's been a starting point for a lot of young artists.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can see I'm on the website actually right now.
Yes, it's really nice.
Sorry, yeah.
They also have the biggest mojitos I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah, they
like,
do.
You really like the size of the whole head. When I first saw that, I was like, this is like for the group, right? Not for one person. And they're like, no, that's an individual mojito. Yeah, that was crazy. Yeah,
it really is a wonderful place. And I remember seeing a great Cuban group, Síntesis, there. They're just incredible. I mean, every Cuban musician there is just absolutely amazing. But the art, so I hope for those Thornton, you know, Anna and Emily, I hope you can make it there. It really is beautiful. Now, I do have a question, and this may be controversial, but this is going to be for all of you, for Anna, Gabriela, Emily, Gray, Thorsten, let me know what you think. Okay. Regarding public space in the United States, as we all know, many people now are removing the Confederacy statues, anything related to the Confederacy with racial overtones and all that. I'm not going to comment on that because, you know, people feel strongly about it. But my argument would be, in terms of what Anna is saying and what Gabriela is saying, it could be a wonderful space for people to talk and to educate. You know, I always say, look, not everyone is literate. Not everyone can read. So here could be a good example of looking at a statue as a historical moment and as an educational tool to talk about the civil rights movement and about America's racist past, which we certainly have a lot of. That's beyond dispute. But it's not a very popular view, my point, because it's now they would say, well, you're supporting the Confederacy. I'm just saying, let's use the space as an educational tool. But what do you think, Anna and Gabriela? Am I completely crazy or is there some logic?
No, I don't think you're crazy because actually public space is for everyone.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, public space is also for protests and to to express yourself. So I mean, some of the street experiments that are done, for example, sometimes they do them with the intention to talk about climate change, for example, to raise awareness and all these things. So I mean, I don't know, like, I would not say if to keep or not a statue, for example, right. But to use the public space to have this conversation or to open the conversation, mm-hmm. I think it's great. Even more because maybe sometimes it's in the place where it happens. So that would be really nice to open the discussion in the specific space and to create this protest, like in United States, how just with the Black Lives movement, mm-hmm. There was this very popular image that was also on the street with the yellow letters.
Right, yes.
Black Lives Matter. That's also a way of expressing, and I think it's good if it's used for everyone's interest and for the good for the good ones.
Oh yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Let's see, there's anyone else? Okay, Greg.
Yes, I am actually glad to hear that I am not the only one who thinks that way, Tom. From an educator's perspective, I believe that for as unfortunate as past or history might have been, we can't erase it. I mean, it is there and it is there for us to learn from it. And same way you say, it's just for us to discuss it. And if we just try to eliminate them and then just replace them with something else, then we will never learn from it. And I do agree that they should just be spaces where, yes, it will start a conversation and it will educate people about whatever historical event, you know, it's representing, that statue or whatever the monument might be.
I have another example, sorry if I might. In Mexico, the 8th of March, it's the Women's Day. And well, as you know, there are many feminicidios. I don't know the word in English. Yeah, women are tired of that. And literally they are killing us and they are violating and even police and everything. So last year, the 8th of March, they went to a statue and they vandalized and also to different monumental buildings just to protest. And the government, the president were really angry because we were like, well, not me, but feminists were making graffitis in sign of protesting. And even one artist who created the sculpture, he said, for me, please throw the sculpture. I don't mind. I don't want one more woman to be killed. If this is a way of protesting, just do it. And the president wanted to protect the statue. And even the artist, they like, please just express yourself. And it's okay for me. I also don't want more women to die. And that's also another way, I mean, of doing it. How it happened in Mexico as an example.
There is another, oh, I'm sorry, go ahead, Greg.
No, I said that you were mute.
Oh, I'm sorry. I keep doing that. But there's another one. I was just looking for a picture. I couldn't find it. But I'll pick on Gabrielle again, because this is with Cuba. I forgot what the name of that statue is. It's the two, I forgot, Jose Miguel, the presidente. Do you remember, Gabriela, with the massacre, the 3,000 Afro-Cubans who were killed in 1912? It's on Avenida de los Presidentes. I forgot what it's called. Well, basically, you know, I'll look for this picture, but in 1912, the president of Cuba had ordered the massacre of over 3,000 Afro-Cubans. They're part of the Partido Independiente de Color. And then the history books didn't really cover it. And then later on, they made this huge, beautiful statue. It's incredible, in honor of this president. And now some people, and then most of them are artists and hip-hop artists, are saying, We should get rid of this. It's terrible. It's a horrible reminder to a horrible man. And some people are saying, well, no, this is very beautiful. We need this for our space. So, do you know what I'm talking about, Gabriela?
No, actually, I didn't know that. But in my opinion, I would let, as was mentioned before, people use the space as they want. If I wouldn't remove the statue, in my personal and professional opinion, but it would be a good educational space, as you said before. And I would add information so people know mm-hmm. what happened. Yeah. Interactive, it could become an interactive educational space. It's not a beautiful statue. Actually, I didn't know about that. And now I realize. And just, but if people after reading and that was mentioned before, after reading what happened, after using the educational space, if they want to do something to the statue, I think it's their right, it's their civic right to just break the statue, paint the statue, everything to express themselves. But it has to be there because you can erase what happened. And I think that's mandatory that people don't erase their history. It has to be there so it doesn't repeat. That's, well, my personal opinion. Yeah.
No, I think you're right. That's what I would do. I would say, look, let's keep it up there, but put a monument or some message or text saying this is why, this is what happened, and this is who this person was and what he did. Because you're right, we shouldn't forget about these things that happen in history. You know, we don't like everything that happened in history, but we can't forget about it. You know, and it's important to do that. Okay, any other questions, or Anna, any other comments?
No, I'm very happy I had this space to share what I'm doing, the things I really like, and yeah, just feel free to contact me later if you have any questions or I don't know, any thoughts later. I'm very open also, like, to hear you.
And I'll be forwarding this recording to everyone. So of course you can see the links and the email addresses, and you'll have Anna's email, and you can just email her directly.
Yeah.
Okay. And then I'll say this again, Gabriela will be speaking to us on April 12th at 2:00 PM Eastern, same time. I'll send that information to you by email as well. Don't worry about it. And the link.
Okay. Yeah. I'm just like writing.
Yeah. So I guess Emily just left. Okay. Well,
yeah, goodbye, she just left the message.
But, yeah. Gabriela will speak next on April 12th. I'll send you the information. Okay.
Okay. Perfect.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Anna. Thank you,
Anna. Anna, thank you very much. Well, that was a lot of fun.
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you. Have a nice evening and day.
Have a good one. Bye.
Thank you. Bye, Torsten. Thanks, Greg. Ciao. Thanks, Gabriela.
Thank you. Bye.
Yeah, bye.